May 7th.
Seven.
I lost a week, I'm sorry. May 7th, to order. Our chair is still not able to join us in person. I am going to call her. The meeting starts. All right, I'm calling her now, apparently. I was calling her when Hoyle Tanner came in. Hoyle Tanner's coming in at 7 o'clock to discuss some proposed engineering work, or potential engineering work on our potential culvert replacement. Call Suzanne.
I think she wanted you there, Josh, too.
Yeah, that's why we're here.
I think that's why they're both here tonight, yeah.
On those minutes. Yeah, this stuff is.
Really? I thought it was the cul-de-sac.
You're going to be working on the manholes on Stockdale, right?
This summer.
Yes.
Oh, okay, Wednesday. I thought we were talking about a tree then that was in the cul-de-sac.
The tree in the cul-de-sac is going to go.
Yes.
That's why I said.
Hello, Suzanne, how are you?
And what about the one?
Oh, I'm good, better, but how are you?
I'm good. You're on speakerphone, just so you know.
Okay, thank you.
And we're done.
Denise there as well?
Well, I'm sorry, Denise is here. Salma is here taking notes. We have George and Ed are both here. And we'll be waiting for Hoyle Tanner at 7, I believe.
Yes, Aaron and Robin Aitman should be coming to the.
And Robin, yes, to give historical perspective as the budding landowner, I guess.
Exactly.
Alrighty, so.
So can we just kind of review some of the ground rules, just so that everybody is clear? We are full quorum.
Yeah.
It would be a quorum even with the two of you.
Yeah.
I'll be in attendance, but I can't chair, so you'll be chairing.
Okay.
And also, it's not clear to me right this very moment that I'll be able to last the whole meeting.
Okay.
And my understanding is that I'm only allowed to vote if I'm in attendance throughout the entire meeting.
Okay. That I wasn't aware of, but okay.
So I don't know that it doesn't mean I can't offer an opinion.
Right.
When you have discussion. But just to keep things on the up and up.
That's fine.
I don't know that votes will come up.
We'll have some controversial votes.
That's my understanding.
Okay. Sounds good to me.
All right, excellent.
With that understanding, we're going to start the meeting. Approval of minutes, April 16th. Denise and myself were in attendance. I don't remember having any edits, but I've been gone for 2 weeks, so I don't remember. Alright, we're going to trust Salome's, trust Salome's notes and Denise's memory. April 30th, we're going to table. I wasn't here, and Suzanne's not voting via telephone, so we'll just table those till next week.
Okay.
Sounds good, thank you, Mike.
Sure. Community input. Going once, twice, three times? All right. Department heads. Building inspector is not in, but I did see him today, and I think there's a number of things that will come up in the folder and later in the agenda. Well, let's just make sure it is on here somewhere. I don't see it, but it says transfer stations. It does pertain to transfer station. There's been some concern by the town clerk about apartment buildings that do not have dumpsters in light of the recent ordinance change. So it seems to make sense that a letter to property owners that should need to apply should probably go out to make them aware. There's a property behind us, apparently, or adjacent to us, that the red house behind us, that does not have one. And I've been told that there's a certain person who works for our town that lives near that gentleman that owns the house, and that person has never once ever witnessed them put out a I won't say what city it is, but city adjacent to us is a trash bag on trash collection day. So they must do something with their garbage. Anywho,
So this is an actual apartment building.
Correct.
That has at least 4 units and it's not a condo.
Correct. Tom and I discussed that. I just came in to review the agenda for tonight because I wasn't sure if you would be here or not. So
Right.
And Tom brought it up, that there are a number of buildings that may need a letter, so if we're okay, he can compile a list with the town clerk and tax collector, and we can review them for, hopefully for next week to go out.
Yeah, great.
There was an issue with the condominiums on Second Street, it's a moot point, the dumpster, thank goodness, is staying. Which was a moot point really, because they were privately owned, they weren't all owned by one owner, which would have made them compliant, but anyways. So that's less of a headache for the town clerk as well. So that's building inspector, code enforcement, in a nutshell. Fire department's not here yet, highway department is here. George, you wanna come on up and we'll hopefully get all your stuff taken care of before Will Tanner shows up.
It won't take long.
Alright.
I'll show you a picture of the salt shed.
Looks pretty empty, George.
Oh, yes, but that's not what I'm looking at, on top of the wall, on where the wood meets the soil.
Where all the salt is?
Correct.
That can't be good for the wood.
That's exactly my point.
So, what are you proposing?
I propose that we buy some pressure treated plywood and put it up on an angle so the cement's not sitting on the wall.
Okay.
And we will install that ourselves.
Just lining around the.
Lining all the way around.
Yeah.
And a suggestion, maybe not for this year, is to empty the whole salt shed and spray it with foundation sealant, because the cement has started to flake already, and we don't wanna lose the building.
Sure.
I have materials for the repairs at under $1,000, I want, I got a PO for $1,000 for Middleton lumber.
Okay.
And the building repairs.
Oh, okay.
If that's something you wanna do, if not, we can.
Is that be that high for?
That's pressure treated lumber and stuff, yeah, so it's over $700 and some odd, not counting nails and screws or whatever we have to hold, but I twice put up to $1,000.
And what do we have in our, we haven't touched anything, have we, anyways?
No, we've done a few small things under the building maintenance, but.
Nothing close to putting a dent in?
Does that include the foundation sealant as well?
That's not including the foundation sealant, that's.
Just a temporary fix, right?
We're gonna have to empty the whole building.
Alright.
This will take care of eliminating the salt from sitting on the walls, it'll, when you, you know, it'll fall back into the salt shed where it should be, but that's salt from saying it's been there since day one, I think. We had to chop it out of there, and so we got those cleaned out already, but.
Suzanne, do you have any comments?
No, so this is a, I'm not sure I followed everything, but it sounds like the salt in the salt shed is actually a causing deterioration of some of the foundation.
You're telling me you can't see the picture over your telephone? So, sorry, I should've described it to you, my fault. So George showed us the picture, the beginning, the bottom half of the salt shed is a concrete foundation, and then built upon that is a, you know, stick frame roof and wall, side walls, that, imagine, you know, your garage that's not finished off, where there's bare studs, there's salt and sand caked in all those cavities. And it's eating away at the rotting, the wood. And George.
That's what they would do.
Yeah, right. And George had also explained to us that there's the foundation is starting to flake away in places too and chip away. So, I mean, this is really a temporary fix, but. So, but it's part of building maintenance, so.
Yep, it's, I'm looking at our budget so far, I know that there are plans for the year, but right now, repairs and maintenance to the highway shed have a budget of $5,000 and an expenditure of $416.
$416, okay.
They are trying to install an exhaust fan at some point, so.
That's being shipped.
Have you already purchased it through purchase order or?
Yes, it's under $200.
Alright, so we've already paid for that, so.
Oh, well, there you go, looks like we're.
So we're installing it ourselves, so?
Yep.
So that's, okay.
So, like I said before, right now, 4 to 1, the budget is $5,000 maintenance for the highway shed and $416 a day.
Okay, so we're gonna, we did this backwards, we're gonna move the purchase order now, we probably should have done that before we discussed it, but.
Okay, purchase order 1417, Middleton Lumber, materials for salt shed repairs.
Not to exceed.
Not to exceed $1,000.
I'll second it. All right, so the budget's in fine shape, so it is only temporary, but we're certainly not gonna be able to reseal it with the concrete this year. What do you have plans? We can build that in the budget maybe for next year?
I can get prices on it, may not be as expensive as we think to have it sprayed.
Okay.
And we'll go there before we put any more salt in it, so we can empty what's there and get at it. And we'll see what happens. If it's gonna be too much, we can do it next year, we can empty the shed next year to do it.
Well.
But this is the start to keep the salt off the top of the.
I mean, does it make sense then to just wait, can we wait a year or?
No, because I think you wanna have this on first.
Okay. Oh, so you're suggesting putting this on and then spraying it?
Yes.
With this, okay, so it's not just a temporary fix?
Yeah, it'll help.
Okay, so this is in addition to something.
The longer we wait on the cement, the more it's gonna deteriorate before we seal it.
I was misunderstanding, I thought you were just gonna do this and then take it off and put it on the concrete.
No, not gonna take it off.
I'm in a much better place now, it took me a while, sorry, Dory.
Sorry, I.
I'm a little tired, no, no, haven't been home that long, so. All right, any other questions? All right, all those in favor of purchase order number?
1417.
Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, those opposed, I guess.
We don't both say, no?
No.
Okay.
Okay, what else we got, George?
Question, I wanna get some gravel stocked up because for the impending road work.
Yep.
And I don't know if you wanna do an open PO for freight for that or.
Well, we don't have open purchase orders, so.
So I don't know exactly what it's gonna cost, we gotta, you know.
Okay.
I just wanna get a few loads stocked up.
Okay.
If it goes over 2 weeks, no.
Do you need it for this week or?
No, I just wanna be able to start bringing some in when we have spare time.
Sure, okay, so if you wanna make some calls and find out what it's gonna be, then we can.
Well, so much time, so.
Sure, find out whatever.
Keep it under the 200, you know, just continue to do it.
If it's under 200, yeah, if it's under 200, you can get as much as you can for under 200 if you want, but.
You know, I mean.
But if it's advantageous, if it's advantageous to do it a larger quantity, then.
Well, it's only the I truck doing it, so we can, you know, we're gonna need more than that. If we do slide, I mean, the winch run and stuff, we do that.
Suzanne?
So we'll be taking it out of that.
Yeah, so I'm looking at, is sand and gravel, would be the sand and gravel line we're talking about?
Yeah.
And then there's a budget of $6,500.
Okay.
So while we don't do blankets or, you know, the kind of, it would be wonderful if we could, and you could still, I mean, if George just wanted to pick a number that seems to make sense, then he could just, you know, do those multiple drives to fill it up. I mean, I can, here's my point. Well, one load of gravel, I don't know how much a load of gravel costs, so while one load of gravel is only, maybe it's less than $200. If you do two of those a day or three of those a day, that still is against the principle of the $200 limit.
Right, okay.
You see what I mean?
Do you have a blank purchase order waiting?
Yeah, I do have a blank purchase. It's just, it's, I think it's $15 a ton, so you're only hauling, you know, you're hauling 8 ton. I don't even know if it's 15 yet.
I have a question. So this is for the work done up on Robert's farm?
It's gonna be, some of it's gonna be, no, I'm gonna keep that separated. This is like, we got shoulder work to do?
Well, that's what this says.
Yeah, this will be out of the shoulder, out of the regular road money, not out of the Robert's farm.
Okay, so this has nothing to do with the.
We'll start that separately when we get ready for that.
Okay.
So is it only for, where did those?
We got some shoulder work, we're doing, we got some storm drains that we gotta fix and stuff, so we're gonna need some gravel to have on hand and.
So the budget line note says we will do more in-house shoulder work.
So is that kept undercover?
No, it's in the, there's a bin over at the transfer station.
And it doesn't like wash away if you have real, real heavy rains?
No, it stays right in that, it's gravel, it's sand and gravel.
Okay.
It's not like salting or deteriorating, it's gonna stay right in the ground.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I mean, is it, I've I have no clue how much a load of gravel costs, like how much one of our trucks of gravel costs. My question is if we could store it. I mean, you know, if it's possible for Triple J to just take a stab at what he thinks he might need, then that would be the purchase order, and he could make however many trips he needs to get it there.
Yep.
And see what happens.
So you want to do a purchase order, George, for up to?
$2,000.
Okay, so make it up to, you want to do it to Pike?
Pike, yeah.
And they can't deliver a big?
They can, but you pay for that.
Okay.
Pay more for the delivery, probably.
All right.
And I figured when, some slow time between projects, one guy can haul gravel, you know, we can do whatever. But we have some shoulders that need, definitely need some work and stuff, so instead of running for a load every now and then, we better have some on hand.
Better to have the material on hand when you start the project.
Right.
And then they go get it halfway through, so.
I'm just gonna put crushed gravel for $2,000.
Okay, so, do you want to move that now, second, and we can talk about it?
Move purchase order 1418 for Pike Industries for crushed gravel, not to exceed $2,000.
Right, yeah, we'll be good for now.
Second that.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions?
It may not even be that much, you know, when we do the other project, we're gonna separate it, so.
Right, this is, the understanding is this isn't for the.
Not for the rubbish.
For that or wood run, it's.
That'll be separate, other than the road money.
This is work you're planning on doing and road ditch work in town, so.
Yep.
Okay, all right, so question is, adoption of purchase order number 1418 to Pike Industries, not to exceed $2,000. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed, all right, thanks, George.
May I ask, I don't know if this is on the agenda, but this is something I'd like George to address, if I may, Mike.
Sure.
So, at the end of the budget training session last Wednesday, George was telling me about this, and I was really not in great shape. And so I think the board, as well as, I think all three of us, would be helped to understand the current state of affairs with the runoff on Church Street, you know, with the property owner who has been making some complaints. So if George could just bring us all up to date on the current state of affairs, I think that would be helpful.
You jog my memory, I actually talked to Tom Clark about that today as well, so go ahead.
I met with Tom last week at the building before. That's been causing the water issue. He's gonna be putting in a drywall to eliminate that problem.
Okay. Go ahead.
I have received a call from the property owner of the complainant.
Right.
I returned the call and have not heard back from her.
Okay.
And told her we had not resolved that issue yet.
Right.
She's expecting us to fix the driveway and stuff that did not get caused by something we did.
Right.
So I don't know if she's gonna have to have a letter or it's gonna become an argument or whatever, but I don't know which way you want me to go with that.
Tom, the conversation I had with Tom today, from when he went over and looked at it, he said it looks like the damage that was caused looks more like from a plow.
From the plow when they plowed it.
From like the person that she's hired to plow her drive or the lot there, so. But anyways, and Tom also mentioned that he didn't believe that the amount of water that would have come through really could have come from this person's sump pump. I mean, it's, you know, that it looks more like it's done by a plow. It's not, but.
The damage on one side of the house is definitely done by a plow.
Yeah.
Some of the runoff might have caused the ditching, the washouting on the other side of the property.
Right.
Which we could put gravel back in there to fill that, but there's no swale or anything. The water's gonna continue to go by that driveway and go into that and wash it out. So I don't, you know.
So until we actually
decide what we're gonna do
with that with Church Street, I don't know where it sits on the schedule. We've talked about it before. We're not gonna put a swale in, are we? I mean, before that, so.
Any
matter.
So, I'm sorry, Denise, you would go ahead.
Okay, any amount of water, heavy rain, or of the snow melting in the spring is going to cause some kind of
right,
affects to everybody's yard and driveway, so I think there's a little standard of, this is normal because of weather related, not because it's our problem.
The only way that could be cured, if it was our issue, which I don't believe 90% of it is to make a swale down the edge of the road, or else put some drainage in there, and that's a major project, so. It's not something that's gonna be relieved by just, you know, if it was a major washout caused by us, but it's still 90% with us dumping the water there, and that's what caused that freeze up this winter.
Okay.
So can I try to sum up what I think I'm hearing?
Sure.
So there are three issues. One is the person, not the complainant, but the person who's been discharging water against an ordinance. And Tom is going to be writing a letter to that effect. Is that correct?
You've already met with him.
He's already met with him, I don't know if you can issue him a letter, just so it's in writing, sure.
Give him a month.
Oh, okay, but they are going to put in a dry well or French drain or whatever.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, good, so that's one issue. Second issue is, what I'm hearing is George and Tom deal with some of the damage that is being described or the complainant is probably due to that person's own plow person, correct?
Correct.
So I don't believe that George, as our road agent, should be in the middle of that kind of a argument.
We all agree with that.
Okay, so if something has to happen, it will come either from us directly or Tom.
Yes.
Would you agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, the third thing is the one I'm a little concerned that, unsure about. And that is, there's still, no matter what, there's still water coming down Church Street. And right now, we have no efficient way of resolving.
Correct.
Is that, all right. Okay, that's it, I just wanted to make sure that George shouldn't be in the middle of trying to figure out the that plow damage. Okay, I'm good.
All right.
I'm gonna ask a stupid question.
Nope, nothing stupid.
When you buy a piece of property that's on a slanted hill or at the end of a slope, how is that the town's responsibility? I don't understand.
See, the problem is there's no storm drains in that section of the town.
But is it required?
No, it's not a requirement.
But they know that when they bought it?
I would think so. That issue didn't happen in the last 6 months, this has been going on.
Okay.
So, we were thinking there was more water coming down Washington and then around the corner. But after seeing what this winter, they're pumping the water out of that cellar, and you can actually see the actual washout coming out of that cellar, that most of that problem was not ours. So that's, if they're gonna continue to pump water down there, when it's above that house with no ice, and you have ice from where it comes out down the street.
So Tom is working on that.
Nonetheless, we can still write her a letter that says, here's what we have done. You know, the property owner was discharging water, will no longer be discharging water, right?
We all can,
yeah. At least help.
Yeah, so we can say that.
Right.
See what happens.
Okay. Work on a letter for her. I'm just making a note right now, but
yep.
All right. So I'll work on a letter I have Tom work on a letter. Well, we can both work on a letter together.
Okay. Anything else, George?
No. Anything for me?
No, that was it, actually. That was the Church Street issue.
Okay.
Anything, Sir Dan?
Yes, to say for Aaron.
Well,
Aaron
conveniently, Aaron has just walked into the room. So we can start earlier if you want. I'm sure Aaron would appreciate it too. All right, so do you want to come on up? And you can say it, George, if you want. You can come on up and we can move.
Is Robin there yet?
Robin's not here yet, no.
Do you think we can wait a few minutes until Robin gets there?
Sure. Yeah. It's probably better than having to do it over again. So it's 4 minutes. So we'll just move on to something else on the agenda real quick then. Police department's not here yet. Fire department's not here yet. Oh, wait. I heard a door open.
Hi, Robin.
I thought I heard a door open. I'm hearing things. Okay, that's an old building. All right, town administration, new and ongoing items. Budget, 2018 quarter one review. Suzanne?
Yes, did you folks get, was someone able to do printout for you?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so until Robin comes in, I can make a few comments.
Okay.
If that's okay?
Sure.
The one budget revision that I am proposing so far is a situation that I think Michael is familiar with, because it happened before you were elected, Denise.
Okay.
So let me bring, we'll bring all three of us up to date. When Tom Dubay, our auditor, was doing one of his random checks, he noted that the three employees who belong to group one, so our administrative assistant, our road agent, and our full-time highway belong to group one. And they were our first experience with group one people. And so we treated them as we treated the fire department folks, in that we didn't put the same percentage retirement. We used the group one retirement rate for their retirement system. But we were only charging them Medicare, the Medicare, the 1.45 Medicare payroll expense. We were not charging them Social Security, FICA, because we don't do that for the police. And no one at the state retirement system mentioned anything to us. We didn't know. It never occurred to us. And so we were wrong. We should be charging, if we withdrawing from the employee share, the fight, the 6.2% FICA from the employee, as well as supplying our share of the FICA. And we were not doing it. We discovered it, I think, two payrolls in 2018. And so what you're seeing as budget revisions would be the payroll tax lines in the executive session, because that covers our administrative assistant, and in the highway department section, which covers George and Ed. We spoke to all three of these employees in early January, as soon as we discovered it. So they're fully aware of it, but we now have to budget our portion of the 6.2%. And so that's the source of the budget revision. We've added the appropriate money to the payroll tax lines in executive and highway department. We've reduced the contingency by that amount.
Okay, is it just George and Ed and Caroline?
Yes.
And
there are only group one employees.
What about 2017?
Uh-huh. So, good question. So, what Tom did was to take the money out of fund balance, because it was an error, whatever term he used. I mean, nobody did anything that they were thinking was wrong. So it came out of fund balance to make them whole.
Right.
And Tom is going to oversee a revised W-2 for those employees. It doesn't, because it's not income, it's not changing their withholding or their tax obligation. But it will affect your Social Security burden, which is why they will need a revised W-2 to submit to IRS. He's in the middle of tax season. He should be over now. It's now beyond April 15th. But Caroline is on him to make sure that he files that revised W-2. And that is coming out of fund balance. And also, the first two payrolls of this year, where we weren't charging, the board at the time agreed to take that out of our, not fund balance, but out of that we did covers both the 6.2% plus, it's just a matter of, I think in all, maybe $500 or $600 for the first two payroll, both our share and the employee share, because it wasn't their mistake, it was our mistake.
Did that include the previous road agent as well? For 17?
Yes.
Okay.
I would say yes. So he will need a revised W-2 as well.
Yes. Okay. And it was only from 17 and 18. It didn't affect anything before that?
Correct.
Okay.
Because they weren't in the
They weren't in the retirement system that. Yeah, okay. And someone's going to notify the previous road agent, right?
He'll get a revised W-2.
Okay.
Again, what Tom Dumay said is it has no effect on your income.
Right.
What it has an impact on is your you know, the social security that you have earned on which your retirement is then based.
Right.
Social security, right. So that's why we do want to submit revised W-2s. And Tom is supposed to said that he would manage that on our behalf.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Welcome.
Right.
So those are the revisions that you see. Is Robin there yet?
Yes.
She just walked in. Are we all set with the quarter one review, or is there more than we need to say about it?
No, there's more, but let's wait. Let's wait.
Okay.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's fine. So we're going to move on to the next portion of our meeting. Discussion with Aaron Champion Boyle Tanner Associates in regard to some potential culvert work down on Sligo Road.
And Michael, would you please make sure that, you know, George and Aaron and Robin are all sort of like at the table so I can, like,
sure, Robin, do you want to sit here at the table? Invite you up afterwards, it makes more sense to come now, I guess. So Suzanne, can you give any comments or questions?
Thank you.
Sure, right there. Okay, so all four are around the table now. I'm going to put the phone closer to them so that we can all hear, okay?
Sounds good.
Okay, so I'm trying to find on the agenda.
Challenge here, so to 36 gut feel is it might be sufficient hydraulically, maybe. I didn't do any engineering to figure out the watershed area and the flows, but a couple things that jumped out at me as being potential problems were there's that old farm dam structure that's immediately upstream.
We don't want to touch that.
Yeah, so we'll have to get this permitted through NHDES, and when you trigger the need for a wetland permit, above a certain size pipe, so I think 36 would trigger you into above a permit by notification. It would be an actual wetland permit. They like to look at other things like, are there historic features in the area that you might be impacting?
Right.
Sometimes it feels like far-reaching, and I guess I would agree with that sometimes too, but you have to go through the hoops of looking at those things, so I would worry that might trigger some sort of historic review, and I just don't know. So what we'd like to do is have what we call a pre-application of who the permit reviewer from NHDES would be for the region for that project and say, this is the general situation, we just want to replace it with a 36-inch pipe. Do you see any problem with that? Because we don't want to spend a bunch of effort doing drawings or pulling this together and then have the permit rejected. So my gut feeling is the reviewers at NHDES are changing, and they're changing with their preference, not for the better as far as making things easy for the towns.
Okay. Of course.
They're oftentimes looking for, see, because it's good that we have this dam immediately upstream, because they can't make the argument that you have some sort of fish, you know, spawning issue. You don't have to necessarily accommodate, like the other Sligo culvert. You know, if we were to replace that, I think, you know, you could, with a straight face, say, well, it probably doesn't need to be open bottom, because you could have some sort of, I don't know what spawning there, but, you know, maybe. Here, you might be able to say, you know, that doesn't make sense. There's nowhere for them to go. So maybe that makes it easier. I don't know. As far as the process goes, if it's a permit by notification, it's, which I'm not sure it is based on size. I think 36-inch, I think you're out of it. But let's say, best case scenario was, it's a couple simple forms, you submit it, within 10 days, you can do the work. You know, you're notifying them, you're doing the work. I don't think that's going to apply here. So that puts us into a typical NHDES wetland impact application, because we have to disturb, there's clearly wetlands there that you disturb to do the work. So the review period for that varies, but up to 75 days, and that's when it triggers, you know, this. We don't want a closed bottom culvert. We want you to look at a buried invert box culvert or a rigid frame or something, which.
So, I mean, 36 inch, it doesn't have to be 36 inches, right? It's small.
Could you go to 24 side by side? Does that change it?
It depends on flow. We have one of the numbers for the side washer area. And
that's what I mean. That's what I want to look at before we do anything.
Yeah, so without having done that, it's not a big effort, but just I hadn't done it yet. Which, the first step was going to be to reach out to NHDES and just kind of talk about the project and figure out where the board wanted to go.
And do we have a current task order with you?
We don't have, so what we were operating on was under a general services agreement.
That's right,
which is
a general
contract that, you know, you can order.
Right.
So that has expired after we finished the culvert project last year.
Right.
So we could work on that. It doesn't obligate you to spend any money. It just gives us a mechanism to sign work. And then we could come up with
can
the
task. Can I interrupt for just a moment?
Sure.
So I agree with Aaron. We discovered that our last general services agreement expired last year. So the first order of business would be to update our general services agreement. So if you could supply us with that, Aaron, the board can review it. But my next question is, you know, based on what I'm hearing, it sounds, Aaron, like you could be writing up a task order for work that you could be helping us with, either in the design or the permitting or both. Am I correct?
Sure, absolutely. And it can be as, again, ideally we figure out that, you know, the culvert only needs to be 24 inches because there's minimal flow there and it's a permit by notification and it's a very simple task. We can do this piecemeal where the first task is just some time to do figure out the drainage area and do some information gathering and then come back to the board and say, this is what it looks like, how do you want to proceed? Whatever the board
might
do.
Yeah, so we do have, under professional services, we do have some money available that could cover a task order.
Okay.
I don't know how expensive this would be, but we have to, you know, we have to see. Also, my other question is addressed to Robin. And does Robin have anything to add or some concerns or issues or questions?
I have a question. Would the state get involved if you simply took the pipe that is within the old one out, so that you then had the original culvert, which we thought was about 6 feet wide?
Sure. That is a good question. If the town does it under the general maintenance of their drainage structures, I don't believe that requires any special permit. It's you have drainage infrastructure that you have to maintain. You don't get a permit or anything.
I don't know what's under there.
Right, there's a reason that was put in. It was like the slabs were starting to fall in, that's something, you know.
No, he felt it was getting plugged up by stuff that was flowing down. And that's, and in fact, there is a gate which George
managed. Right, he put a metal gate in front of that.
Why he did both is unclear.
Sure.
But if he just put the gate, it might have been perfectly fine. But, because the gate, you know, has, opens about that big.
Yeah.
The original culvert itself is clearly big enough. And I know that George is kind of worried about how you do it, and I don't know myself whether you would have to dig down, and because you want to get rid of that second pipe, right?
Right.
Whether you would have to dig
that second pipe, we're already in trouble.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
And then from there, you could be in a position so you could remove the riprap that is kind of stabilizing the smaller pipe that's put in the original one, and then lift the old pipe out. Because apparently, my son remembers when this happened, and originally it was done, I think, one of those big backhoes thing like this, and he simply put it in this way, and then put the brick wrap around it. So I'm just wondering whether you could do that, and maybe you're going to have to dig the first pipe out, but whether you do that or not, whether you can reverse that whole process and get the old one out. And then you'd be in a position to see. I mean, George, I think, is a little worried about this, the condition of one side of it. But at that point, you would be in a position where you could see what the situation was there.
That might be a good first step. And to be safe, maybe we fill out a permit, find a notification that the DES know we're doing some work. But something, you know, this is obviously on record, so there's things that I can't advise you to do on record. But maintenance of you have to maintain your infrastructure, and you don't need a permit to do that. So if you take the pipe out and you can do some information gathering and figure out what's there.
I'm not sure what's going to happen when we pull that out.
Yeah, I guess
but that's why you have to do it, it seems
to me. I mean, if it collapses, then the road's closed.
Right. So, that's a good point. I wouldn't advise you to take it out if the reason for it being installed is unknown. Was this Jeff that put it in?
No, way before. Ron Kerrigan, I think, put it in.
Okay.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yes, please.
It sounds from what I'm hearing that it's a concern about. So I hear everything. You know, we can maintain our infrastructure, and so if we believe in the maintenance of our infrastructure, we just need to pull out the culvert that's put in, the granite culvert. Then we could do it, but there's concern about what might happen because we're not exactly sure why it gets put in there. Is that what I'm hearing?
That's correct, yes.
It's in there, that small pipe is in there because Ron thought that was somehow he was going to be able to prevent it from clogging up.
But what if you damage the bigger pipe that one's in? Then
it's actually
really
in a granite.
It isn't a pipe at all.
No, it's a granite.
It's a granite structure.
Okay.
If you've ever seen the culvert down where the Rogers house is at the bottom of the steep hill, you can go inside and actually look at it. This is almost a replica.
Oh, okay.
So if we took that top
pipe out. A granite box,
Is there a pipe within the granite box now?
Yes, that's the problem.
Which reduced the size of it by.
See, that's what Ron did.
Yeah, I want to say it was a 3x4 box originally, and maybe it's reduced now to maybe a 24-inch diameter pipe.
I think
that's in there.
So it's half your flow.
I will say,
but
there's
another one on top of that, right?
Yeah. By the time the water goes up to that top one,
right?
Yeah.
There's trouble.
So I think one of the problems we have here is that during major storm events, you have the Salmon Falls River, which is at full stage, and that is going to back up into this area. So you're going to lose a lot of capacity just from the tailwater of the Salmon Falls. So I think to alleviate the flooding that we've seen in recent years, it would have to be probably a much bigger pipe. You'd probably eliminate some of the overtopping during smaller events that you've seen, but in order to not have overtop during 100 year, it's going to be probably a much bigger culvert and maybe an overflow culvert further to the north. It's a much bigger project to really fix the problem here. But it doesn't mean you can't do some things to improve it. It depends, I don't know what the board is thinking here.
It never, I mean, it worked perfectly fine until this small pipe was put in. We didn't have that overflow, and that was when the road was considerably lower than it is now, because at some point, they raised the Sligo Road by a foot or two. Because I can remember when the river came up and actually went over all the road.
Yeah.
And as you're saying, if you have a really heavy storm, at high tide, the river is going to be so high that regardless of how big a clump you have,
right,
it's not going to move. You've got to wait until that
yeah.
tide goes out.
Mm-hmm. At that point, you need to raise the road above the storm tide elevation, and is that a cost that you want to bear? Probably not.
I don't think you need to.
Right.
Well, I think getting the full flow back, at least the size of what's the bottom one,
mm-hmm.
is what we need.
So,
and that's reduced
yeah.
by half right now by putting
yeah.
that pipe in there.
Yeah.
Was the road paved when the second?
No.
It wasn't when the second one was put in?
Oh, I don't remember. The road was paved kind of in sections. It started, I think, went down as far as, where the sheet.
Right,
with
dry up. Oh, okay, yeah.
And then it went up, I think, to Pinch Hill.
Okay.
Something like that.
Right.
I mean, it was done in sections, and I don't remember.
Okay. Would have been a lot easier to put it in if it wasn't, probably, so. Interesting.
So did the board and Aaron and Robin and George, the board believe that perhaps a good way to start is to have an engineering assessment and perhaps some options?
Yes. And I'm concerned if George has noticed since he's been here in October that we've had to close the road twice. We certainly don't want to lose the road.
We certainly don't, because the farm is implicated.
Correct. Well, yes, there is a business that's implicated, but it's also going to be a lot more expensive to replace that section of road if it fails, right? So.
Absolutely, right. Aaron, how long might it take for you to put together a task order for us to look at, and then for you to, come up with some options? What would you think?
I could have a task order for the next meeting, which I assume is next Monday, and then it really, we can help as little or as much as the board wants.
Right.
I understand. Try to work within the confines of your budget.
Well, there are two budget issues here. One is professional services, which would be your task order. And the second one, if the task order is for engineering options and designs or whatever, the second one is what are we going to do and how much is that going to cost? Right?
Right.
So I don't like playing games. So I want everybody to know that right now we have $10,000 in a culvert fund.
Right.
Okay, that's it. And then we have the difference in our road maintenance contract between what it's going to cost us to do the pipe contract, right, which we just voted on, which is close to $300,000.
Right.
Whether we don't know whether there may be any cost overruns associated with that, but
right.
we have the difference between whatever that is and $325,000.
Correct.
So.
We need to be very careful.
So if it looks like if we can't summon resources to do what might need to be done, is there any, intermediate something or other that we could do within the funds that we might have available? I mean, I'm just talking off the top of my head. I have no idea.
Well, I guess that we need to wait to see how much, what oil tank comes up with, or what coal mine needs to really be done, right? I mean,
I've already got a price to replace that culvert.
Completely replace it?
Completely replace that culvert the way we wanted to do it. Take that out, put it 36-inch pipe in.
Okay.
Not counting engineering and what have you.
Yeah.
If we can go with the 36-inch pipe, it's gonna be less than $15,000.
Okay. And that's just.
Well, that's doable.
So that's taking out.
It's taking that down, saving all the granite and using it for head walls on each side.
That's removing the granite box and replacing it with this 36-inch culvert.
Correct. And using all that granite to make the head wall and then rip wrap each side.
Okay, so I know that when we worked on the upper, the other Sligo Road culvert, it was great respect, attachment, I don't know what the word to use, but that granite box had been built, you know, in Civil War era, perhaps,
so
maybe
a
bit later.
That's what I.
And so there was attachment of the historical significance of that. So I'm just saying that. I know you can't always live in a museum. I know, and I have these same feelings myself of, you know, needing to do the right thing and yet being respectful of our history. So just saying that.
How much would it cost if you simply took out the pipe that's in Big One?
I can't even throw a price at that. I don't know what it would cost to have an excavator come in and do that. We can look at it if that's another option, but again.
I mean, thinking that could be, if it was a reasonable price, that would be a reasonable first step.
If it was in good enough shape, you could just remove the pipe.
That's what I'm saying.
See, my concern is now that they filled that in and you had the. What damage did they cause by not having, you know, if it was filled in completely or if it just the head walls were filled in?
Right, we won't know until you open it up, right? So.
Right.
You mean, I think they just filled out where they could see the pipe.
That's exactly what my thought is.
Yeah, which is.
So we don't know if water got inside there and, you know, could it cause more damage or maybe that pipe's collapsed.
Could be too.
Yeah. I mean, what I was thinking of that first step was you wouldn't worry about that second pipe, which you really don't like. You just see about removing the first pipe and then see what you have. Because then you really could see whether you have a decent, you know, structure.
I mean, if you could just replace, just remove the pipe and not do anything else, that would be the best case, but I doubt that.
I mean, we can.
There are a lot of unknowns.
Right.
I think you'll be surprised by engineering analysis how inadequate what's there is now.
Right.
And just the rainfall events that we're using for a 50-year storm, they're a lot more than we were using 10 years ago. You know, the rainfall events are more intense.
And regardless of whether or not we go with just completely replacing or not, we still have to have some engineering done. We have to figure out, well,
you wouldn't if you just remove the pipe.
Okay, maybe.
What I bet you would find out whether you needed engineering or not.
Right, well, is it setting a scope down to see if the pipe has in fact collapsed? Can you see all the way through with a flashlight?
That's the problem. You could see through the pipe. I think everybody's worried about it's around the pipe.
Well.
And,
they just don't understand the logic of putting the pipe in the first place. Why?
Well, nobody does.
Right.
See, that would,
right.
A lot of people shook their heads.
Normally, you see a cracked stone, you start seeing roadway, you know,
right.
Sinkholes.
And the road is collapsing on top of that, but I don't know what's causing that collapse on top of it.
Right. So in that situation, you say, well, we'll basically slip line this, and if it collapses, it just collapses on our pipe. And so that's really hard, because you can't, like, yeah, the pipe might be totally fine, but I don't know.
But it does seem to me that the fact that we have the tide in the river means that whether it's bigger than it used to be or not is really not applicable, because when that tide comes up, the water isn't going to go out anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess it's those other events. It's the thunderstorm in the summer when you get 3 inches of rain in a short period of time. That's when you get more flow coming in and the culvert can't handle and you might get overtopping. But I don't know how often that might occur or not.
Well, it didn't used to, is all I can say. And as far as the road is concerned, Jordan's done some really good work, whereas he found out where the water needed to you know, get off the road, and he filled it with riprap kind of stuff. So now, when it does go over the road, it's going to go through this on top of the rocks, and it's not going to erode on the side of the road itself.
Have
so I think you made the road pretty good, George.
Have you done all Sligo yet?
No, I actually just moved. It was too high.
Okay.
The riprap was too high, stopping the flow of water, so I opened up a couple of spots for the water to run off.
Yeah.
Right.
And he let it go down the bank, so it has a good place
to
go.
But prior to that, the riprap was too high, and it was, I mean, we had 6 inches of water going across that road a couple weeks ago.
Right.
And then, of course, the edge of the road, it's got to be ditched all the way through anyway, because it's right on the edge of the hot dog, and the hot dog's going to start breaking off, so I mean, we're going to be losing.
Right.
But we got to stop the problem from the water not getting from one side of the road to the other.
Right.
And that's what we got to look at that culvert.
Suzanne, any other questions? Concerns?
It's difficult to follow everything, but if we're still at a point where we think some initial engineering assessment evaluation, you know, along with input that we just received from George and Robert, I'm always interested in what a professional engineer might suggest.
Right.
But that's me.
No, I don't disagree with you. So let me ask you, Robin, as a resident and budding landowner from this, if we had to remove the, how concerned would you be in removing the original granite structure and replacing it with a pipe? And you
well, I'd just be sad,
saying.
Let's put it
right.
That way. I mean, I'm sure that can be done and would work.
There doesn't seem to be that same level of, not just you, but in general, same level of attachment to the smaller one than there is to the larger one.
Well, don't say smaller and larger, because I think they're the same size. You do, too, don't you?
No.
No, the one off the street. This one's off the street.
They're
standard, right?
Yes.
The other one, you can walk
there.
Right.
Well, my son used to go walk through the one that's...
Walk through that?
I'm not saying he walked there, but they used to go through
there. I don't know. What did you have? 2x3?
I thought it was 3x4.
3x4, so.
And the other one was much larger, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
The other one's 6x6.
Right.
Yeah.
I thought it was stand up there.
That's
just there.
My son, if you were here, he would probably be able to tell you what he remembers and how big it was.
And I'm sure if it's 3x4, you're going to
crawl
through it easy enough. But again, now it's reduced up a third.
Terrifying to think of it now.
Well, that's what the boys will hear.
Right.
Anyway. So some quick steps could be to calculate the watershed area, figure out the flow, and figure out permitting requirements.
Right.
And then regroup on what to do.
Because I don't want to touch the dam either. I think that it looks good, and I think we can make it look good with putting in the culvert and dressing it all up neatly and heavy traffic flow the way you want to flow it.
Well, I think those initial questions probably need to be answered before we start.
But I don't want to take
anything out of the trouble with the state.
So, have we asked Aaron then to provide us with a task order that the board can then review?
Not officially, but I think we're about to do that.
Okay, so it doesn't require a vote. I think that's just fine because the vote is actually on the task board when we receive it. So I think just by consent, we can just, for general consent, we can just ask if that's and you feel that that's a good idea.
I think it's good to know what we're dealing with, yeah. And see the scope of, the initial scope of what he thinks would require, yeah. I don't like to go into this blind one, so that's just me.
So, Aaron, you're okay with providing us with a task?
Yes. We'll do this as incrementally as possible. So, just an initial bare bones stuff and figure out where to go.
All right.
Yeah.
You good with that, Suzanne?
Okay. Yes, and then we can review it again with George and also Robin, I think, as a pretty interested party in all of this.
So when we had talked about this last time, we actually put together a task order last February with similar sort of bigger scope, because at that time you were talking about, can we get this into the Bridge Aid program? Because I felt it would be easy from an environmental and maybe even hydraulic perspective to say this would be a 10-foot structure because of the tailwater.
Okay.
And that would get you into the Bridge Aid program. But
okay.
Funding is 10 years out with that, but
right.
It's 80% state and
20%
local.
Right.
So we were talking about maybe looking at short-term versus long-term, but I don't know if they're still interested in that or not. If 36-inch works and solves the problem, then I don't see the need to go that route. But I think the concern was that the watershed, you know, that it was well undersized, they were looking at twin or triple 36s maybe. But, you know,
okay.
Without looking at it, it's a bigger watershed than I believe than the other Sligo culvert. But I may be misspeaking.
That's hard, because there's an awful lot all the flow that comes down that Sligo Brook to the other one. And you have the same situation. We're not quite the same situation with the tide, because although it seems as though that's pretty much, you know, the same level as the river, in fact, that little red house that's right there has never flooded. Even when my barn, which is at this end of the road, it's one of my barns next to the river, has flooded, the red house has never flooded. So you've got a different situation there. It's not the way it looks to the eye. I'm sure your machines could say what that difference was. But the water does not come up in the same way that it comes up for the one here.
Now, I'm not opposed to putting two side by side, so whatever comes up when we look at it, if we need to put two in there, we'd be kind of doing it.
So the problem, hydraulically, if we need turns on 36s,
yeah, I'm sorry, my landline, sir.
I guess I think your house phone is ringing, so.
I couldn't hear.
That's where permitting might come in. If we say it needs to be double 36, they're going to say, you should, perhaps they would say you should consider a different type of structure that's going to be more expensive, but.
That's why I wanted to have you look at it.
Yeah. A phone call, a 15-minute phone call with the reviewer saying, this is the situation we have. What would you be requiring of this?
Look, I don't want. I'm not wanting to do anything until we know we're going to do this once.
Yeah.
Well,
we are. Yes. Someone else will be dealing with it a long time in the future, hopefully. Any other questions, Suzanne, or anyone else in the room?
No, I just want to thank Robin for coming and Eric for coming and George. We want to make sure that.
Thank you.
Look,
Two purchase orders, first one, number 1394, the two-way communications in Newington. It's time for our annual recertification for our four radar units for $250, and that will come out of our radar maintenance line item.
I move purchase order 1394 for two-way for radio certification, radar certification for $250 each. No, is it $250?
Total
of $250.
Second. Any questions or comments, discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed? All right.
Purchase order number 1393 to the city of Dover. We had to replace a sway bar in the Cruiser 72. I anticipate it's going to be less than 200, but I did a purchase order here for 250 just in case it goes over with the labor. And that will come out of a different maintenance line item.
Okay, I move purchase order 1393 to the city of Dover to replace the sway bar in Cruiser 72. For $250.
So.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
I would just like to appreciate Chief Ducharme, Chief Rutherford, Road Agent Gilman, and all our other department heads who are really making an effort to get purchase orders in before the purchase. Our auditor will be appreciative, and I certainly am very appreciative. Thank you, Bob.
You're welcome.
Last week,
anything to make your life easier.
Okay. That being said, thank you, Suzanne. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed. All right.
And the last thing I have for you folks, I don't know if you noticed on Portland Avenue at Roberts Road, but we have a message board sign up there that the Lee Police Department has been kind enough to let us use for the next several days, advising motorists to drive carefully and not to pass on the right, using the breakdown lane as a passing zone.
Right.
Actually, starting tomorrow, we're going to be start working the traffic enforcement grant that we received many, many months ago. In particular, the Roberts Road, Bear Road, Route 4 corridor.
Right.
So.
Well, I have to say that I was on Route 4, and I was stopped to go on Roberts Farm, and the woman behind me stopped behind me. However, the guy coming in the other direction,
mm-hmm.
on the right,
because
yeah. he didn't see the sign.
Yeah, right.
But it did go
on one
out of two, but...
And the traffic, especially in the afternoon, coming from Dover, is worse than what's going west.
Yeah, it was about 5 o'clock when I was coming out. So, but it worked.
That's all that I have for you folks. Anything for me?
I think this was one of the pieces of advice that either you, Chief Ducharme, or one of our DOT folks said when we were talking about safety on Portland Ave. So
yes,
we're just following through on one of those pieces of advice from whomever it came. It could have been you. It was probably you.
Would it be good, because I know we can't have these signs all the time, like getting a sign made to say that? You know, a metal sign and putting it up?
The state would have to put that up.
The state does.
Their permission to do it.
Okay.
Because
I can't do it one way, maybe we'll do it another.
We actually have in the master CIP plan to purchase one of those type radar signs.
Right.
Actually, it might be next year, I'm not sure. We'll be
okay.
So.
You'll be looking at that soon.
I shall.
Yeah. Anything else from the chief?
Yes. No. All right, thank you.
Good night.
Thank you.
Get better.
Thank you.
All right, we're back to town administration. We're going to go over the 2018 quarter one review. We ended off with retirement issues. So.
It was actually FICA.
Due to the retirement.
Yes.
Snap.
Yes, with group one people. So we've got it straightened out, but we did have to do a budget revision. The other thing for the, please feel free to ask questions. I will say some of what I have noticed is, and I spoke to Caroline a little bit this morning, is that there has been an increase in the cost of fuel oil, heating oil, propane, whatever, as well as electricity. our utilities costs in the general, in the government building sections, you'll see that our pace of spending is a bit higher than last year.
But.
I didn't revise the budget. I thought, let's give it another quarter, let's see what happens.
Right.
But that means.
That's something I noticed.
But that could be because of the extremely cold winter that we had had as well, don't you think?
That's quite possible. That's why I think it's a little too early to actually revise the budget.
Right.
Yeah.
Talking about the spinning tool is just say, and we've already put in place, you know, the our 28, for the most part, our 2018 road plan.
Right, okay.
All right, and when you see it, you can always, you know, if you find some suggestions. But usually, our recording secretary sitting at the end of the table is always good at using her, is it a red pen and making things as short as possible so everything can fit, so we'll see.
Right.
Okay.
Perfect.
Is she laughing?
Yes.
She's smiling.
She's smiling. No, I think you should.
That's good.
Just go for it.
Okay, so, is there anything else for the review, then we're good?
The review we're good, but I think there's 2019 there.
Yeah, that's gonna be, moving on to the next one, the 2019, the timeline, CIP and default budget.
Yes, so Denise?
Yes.
I'm gonna get the CIP to you, I hope very early next week, will that work?
You mean the report that shows where the money has gone into, to the projects?
Yeah.
Yes, that's fine. Yes, yes, and then after that, after I get that, I will set up a meeting.
All right, great.
With the CIP committee.
And that should answer your question about the police, the amount for the police?
Correct.
Okay, so I hope to get that to you early next week.
Okay.
The other thing about timeline is that, you know, with SB2 and blah, 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 I'm wondering, I thought we were too late last year, SB2 or no SB2. I thought we were still working on things.
Right, I agree.
Way too late. And I think the reason is, it may not have seemed too late based on other years, but I think now we have, because of our planning tools, and what we have, you know, a change there makes a change in, you know, one or two other places.
Right.
And so, it just takes longer to make sure everything is in sync.
Yes.
So I'd like us to come up with a timeline that we can send out to, like, department chairs, trustees, and whatnot. I don't know what it is, but just please have your budget to us by budget and such.
I would suggest.
So I just kind of think about that.
I would suggest, so that the, who puts it out? Well, the Secretary of State has the political calendar. The Municipal Association also has another calendar, sort of syncs all the dates together. Probably they're probably the better calendar. We start there, and we look at, you know, the due-by dates for all the different pieces of the budget, and then we work backwards from there. Would probably be the easiest thing to do. So, you know, department heads, you need to have your budget in by A, because B and C need to be done by the Select Board and Budget Committee by a certain date.
At least give us a heads up about, you know, if there's going to be any huge surprises, because I, you know, we should be starting in September if there is, just because of a lot of extra meetings to, you know, if a particular department is coming in with something large. But, you know, end of September, early October, for sure.
And we all need to be cognizant of the...
I like end of September.
Yeah, yeah.
Sure.
Great.
You know, if you could say September 15th, then I'd be okay with that.
Yeah.
So we also need to be cognizant of the fact that we may or may not want to, I lean towards not wanting to, but having our deliberative sessions for the school or the town either together or on separate days. I know that Charlie's been reaching out to the Municipal Association to see if it's possible or plausible in both cases. And I don't remember exactly what the guidance said, but I seem to recall that there needs to be an action, I think, by the town meeting to allow it to be on the same day, but I don't recall if that's, or if that's true or not, but...
My opinion is it's a no.
Well, but, so, these are still factors that we need to think about, right?
Yeah.
So when we're scheduling. Or trying to build our schedule.
Exactly.
So if we were expecting to have things, if we had to have things done a week later or a week earlier or 2 weeks or whatever the timeline is, than what the school does, you know, we try to work in concert as much as possible so that we're not duplicating meetings if we don't have to. But,
right, but I'm just off the top of my head, I think two deliberative sessions on the same day is like marathon.
I mean, it may be too much, right? So, I mean, that's just something, one more thing we need to consider when we're trying to put this calendar together, so.
All And so I think the other, I don't have these in this in front of me, but I think the other subsection of that is the small budget.
Yes, yep.
So, this is just a really preliminary thought on my part, but I would love to have Denise work in the default budget. And I would also love to have, if we could, I would love to have Denise work with me on some of the early things that I do to get a budget ready. If we could do this as an administrative meeting, not a workshop, not a whatever, and I'm not excluding you, Mike, I just think that as a...
He doesn't look sad. No worries.
Let me just clarify for everyone in the room, if I'm understanding what you're saying. There are administrative sections to putting the budget together, i.e. the spreadsheet.
Yes.
That I don't necessarily need to be sitting there listening to how you've constructed the spreadsheet, but Denise may want to be there.
Putting in the formulas.
I'm okay with not putting in the formulas, so I understand how the process works. I don't necessarily have to do that. It's fine.
I would be happy to.
Nice if one of the member did.
I would be happy to.
Workshop.
Yeah.
For our budget workshop. There'd be, okay, now what we see here, here's what, you know, here's just what is put together just from what, general, just like I've done in the past, only Denise would be sort of with me so that when I'm not there next year, you know, you're not sunk.
Yep, I'm okay with it.
All right, super. So if Mike is okay with that, then we'll just set the
moment. Mike is okay with
administrative
that.
Meeting, not workshops, just here's the formulas I use, here's how we're trying to
sure.
And then at the same time, you can maybe use some of that and be working on the small budget aspect.
Sure.
Okay.
And Mike and Denise, I think Caroline's going to try to make sure, Denise, that you get the emails from the Municipal Association that talk about their, I think they said that once a week or once every other week. On the legislative summary.
Okay.
The legislature just changed before I went on vacation SB2 law around default budget. So.
Yeah, I mean they're tweaking the default budget thing.
Yeah, we.
What we learned at the training
session. Right,
at the training
center last week. Yeah, I mean we don't know 100% what's going to definitely going up to be revised.
Not necessarily probably affect the town much, the school's not much.
They're just kind of tweaking it so it's.
Right.
You know, a little more detailed
than
what you can and cannot do.
Yeah. So we'll need to know when that's finalized. That's the point I think we're trying to say.
Right.
So whichever one of us finds out that it's final, then we need to be able to see how it affects the building of this default budget.
Yep.
I don't think it'll affect us all that much. We don't have a lot of vacant positions.
Yeah.
School may potentially have vacant.
We do have some
one-shot
things in the budget that we probably can't
keep. Yeah, for sure.
So,
yeah, that makes sense. But.
All right, so that was what that was about.
Okay, we're good on that one. So the next is manager of the transfer station.
So one of the things that I'm going to do is just make some, I don't even know if it was a recommendation. I was just going to say, here's what it would cost us to do that.
Okay.
I have not done that.
Okay.
I still have to do the revenue, the executive summary, the CIP. So those things are going to come first.
Yeah.
So we can keep that as a reminder.
Mm-hmm.
It might be beneficial to talk with George again as well to see exactly what he was envisioning.
Good idea.
Just to make sure the plan hasn't evolved.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was sort of an initial thought of this, right? So that hasn't really been talked about a lot. So. Okay, but you're working on see if it's even financially feasible. Okay. Alrighty, if there's nothing else to say about that, we're going to move on to post-meeting chores. I can tell you that the election for planning board chair will happen tomorrow evening. It's the first thing on the agenda. Well, the first thing on the agenda is to call the meeting to order, but. Second thing on the agenda is electing the chair. So I will be officiating until
the chair is elected, and I will be happily handing it off to him or her.
And I believe that Carolina Denise are working on the ZBA.
That was going to be my next question, yes. I believe so.
Yeah.
For, which may come in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Potentially.
I think next week.
Next week?
Yeah, I thought it was.
Did it get some notice yet, or?
No. I think we're waiting for, to hear back from somebody.
Oh, to see if they actually want to have the,
yeah.
If they need to.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, well, they probably will send it out in time, so. Or make the decision in time, so notice can go out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that covers the election of chairs. Management response?
No.
We'll add it to your long list of chores.
Table.
We will table, I'm happy to table that. Transfer station stickers from one vehicle to the next. We've resolved the immediate case, but we need to, and I wanted to keep this on here until I get back from vacation. It's whether what's practice versus what the ordinance says, and the ordinance is silent, as I recall. The practice has been silent. So if someone buys a new vehicle, the practice has been to charge them, I think it's $5 to get a new sticker.
Yep.
But the ordinance doesn't actually say that, as I recall.
Mm-hmm.
So I would imagine we probably want to change the ordinance to reflect what the actual practice is, if that's what the majority of the board wants to do. But, and I'm happy to work on some language. I said I'd work on it when I got back. So if we want to think about fixing that.
I think it's a good idea to have our ordinance be explicit for these kinds of things, because otherwise we're all looking at each other.
Mm-hmm.
I'll make one other comment about transfer station ordinance.
Yeah.
I think there's some overall inconsistencies.
Yes.
So our choice is either spend lots of time trying to fix it all, or say, look, we just don't have those thoughts and time right now, but let's at least put down what we know is an issue, and that is replacement of.
Right. So there are, in my mind, there are two issues on top of, there's only one other issue that really, I think, needs to be resolved sooner than later. One is this issue with transferability from vehicle to vehicle. And the second is property owner versus resident. So just because you own an apartment building in the town of Rollinsford, doesn't mean that you yourself get to have a transfer station if you live out of town. If you are a resident of that apartment building, then yes, of course you can have a transfer station sticker. It should be a moot issue, really, because after four or more units, your landlord is supposed to provide removal, but there seems to be some concern by those that are issuing the stickers that there are a number of landlords that are utilizing our transfer station but don't actually live here and aren't producing the garbage here, which is a violation, because you have to produce the garbage or the waste to put it in the transfer station. But,
right.
So we might want to try to clean that up, too.
Yeah, I mean, I think those are all things that we visit every year.
Yeah.
I'm gonna get on my soapbox again, though, and say that I would love to have somebody at the time to, you know, do a financial analysis on, you know, bags, paper bags, whatever it's called.
Bag and tag.
Yeah. Because it's the town and city or town, whatever the municipal association provides as a monthly magazine.
Yeah.
About 3 or 4 years ago, they did provide an analysis.
Yeah.
And there are towns that say that it has worked for them, in the sense that those people who don't generate much waste, like maybe our people who live alone, some of our elderly citizens, they don't have to pay as much as, you know, people who are just, you know, bringing bag after bag to the transfer station.
Right.
And, you know, we still have to provide a transfer station sticker, but in that case, it may be free. Just show us your registration.
Right. Yeah, I don't know.
You know, so, but, well, I bet, you know, that requires some group of people who have sometimes do that.
It might be cheaper in the long run in the sense that out of direct taxation would cost them less. Right, yeah, I don't know. If we find a group of folks that want to take that on.
Yeah, so I'm not saying, but what you're going to propose to do, Michael, is spot on, and it will, you know, fix some holes that are in our current transportation ordinance, so that's good.
Alright, so I'm making a note to at least look at transferability. And owner versus resident.
Yes.
Actually, resident versus owner.
Yes.
Alright, I will do that. Hopefully have something for the next week or two.
Thank you.
Yeah, alright, so we will, I'm going to table then. I under C, just so we keep it on the calendar. It was on it, dumpsters for buildings of 4 or more units. I didn't see it earlier when we were talking about it. Under department head, are we okay with the town clerk and tax collector and compiling a list of those landowners that may need to be put on notice that they need to get a dumpster for their buildings?
If that's an ordinance in town, yeah.
It's part of the new minimum housing standards. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's part of it. However, we think it's the best way to try to get in touch with you.
Right,
because someone told me, I didn't even know, someone told me that maybe it happened tonight at this meeting, the red house that
yes.
busted the town hall.
Yes. I found that out today.
Huh?
I found out about that today.
Yeah, so maybe it was you earlier. It's an apartment building, it's at least 4 units, and it has no dumpster.
Right.
So, yeah, so any way that we can, you know, compile a list, that could be helpful.
Right. Okay. Then I will tell them that it's okay to start doing that.
Okay.
I'm going to find her on the agenda of loss, okay? Just making a note so I can tell people that will be responsible for doing that. Alright. Next is hydro relicensing field work. So the email that I saw earlier today, I was trying to review and get caught up on email. The process is ongoing. They're going to be doing a survey of eel population in the Salmon Falls River.
They're going to be doing a lot of testing.
Yeah.
And so throughout this summer and maybe early fall. And so the engineer, I think it's Kirk, somebody or other.
Yeah.
This is like the first study. So I finally did read it. I had no stamina to read it when it first came through. But I did read it.
Right.
And so I did write back and say, please get in touch with our police chief.
Right.
And also, please get in touch with the mill owner. So I gave him Brian's email and Ducharme's email.
Perfect. That was going to be what I was
going to say. When I read that, I don't know, well, I had no other comments to make on that. I don't know.
The only other person I could think of is maybe the fire chief. I don't even know why.
You did have him on copy, though.
Oh, you did? Okay.
You had Mark on copy as well.
I did? Oh, okay, good.
I couldn't remember.
Because I thought the same thing.
Yeah.
Only because they're down in the water.
Right,
area
exactly.
And it really got rapid, you know, it's nice for them to know that something's
right,
going on down there.
Fish come out,
yeah.
Right,
so.
And they're doing it at night, I think.
Right, that's
some
what it said
it, yeah.
At night, yeah.
Yeah, so I did copy Mark.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So I noticed you had said you wanted to do notice to the public, which I think is fine and it's important, but I think we need to be careful. I don't think there'd be a large crowd that would show up. I don't want to disrupt this person's study. If they need to be doing a legitimate study of eel population and, you know, and they're attracted by light, so they have a lot of people down there with flashlights, I don't want to disrupt the process. So we should let people know what's happening. We don't necessarily let them know every specific night that's happening,
right.
You know.
Right.
I don't want to disrupt the study. I skew it one way or another.
I hear what you're saying. So of course, the easiest thing would be to take the engineer's 2 paragraphs and send that along to Theo.
Yep.
If you have an objection to what that says,
I
who's going to change that, I guess.
Well, I'm going to try to look at it now while you're on the phone, I don't know if I can. I don't know if my phone does that. I don't believe I don't think I'd have an objection, but it was, I don't know, I read it earlier today and I was much more tired actually than I am now. Jet lag is a wonderful thing.
I hope you had a great time.
I did actually. It was a wonderful, wonderful getaway. All right, so, there's an email from her. Just looking for the...
It could be embedded in mine.
It is, yeah. That's what I'm trying to find. It. Tap down. To make you aware that we are planning to conduct the first nighttime eel survey on the Rollins or on Lower Great Falls Dam next week. We're tentatively scheduling and equipped the date. For your background, the surveys will begin just after nightfall. I suspect we'll need 3 to 4 hours to cover both sites, but we'll gain better access. I don't know, Suzanne, now that I'm reading it.
I mean, you don't want people to start calling and saying, hey, there are these people with, right.
If we just...
flashlights.
Right. So maybe if we cut off the first couple of sentences and just go with the work, we can just say that there will be nighttime surveys of the Salmon Falls River between the Rollinsford Lower... Rollinsford Dam and the Lower Great Falls Dam next week, and then skip down to the work will consist of walking the short river reach below each dam and inspecting the downstream side of each dam, basically looking for eel activity. Handheld flashlights will be used to help traverse, blah blah blah. The surveys are expected to continue one night per week through the end of June. So that way, people will know that it's happening starting next week through June, and that if they see people down there by the river with flashlights, that they're there for a reason.
Michael, would you have time to call Tifa? I'm going to be calling Caroline tomorrow, but she's actually not in.
No, I can just cut and paste the email when I get home tonight and just forward it on.
If you can cut and paste it, then use our brand new posting.
Do we have a new email address we're using? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
Posting, it should be all P-O-S-T-I-N-G.
Okay. All right. I can do this. All right.
Well, that would be super. Thank you.
You got it. Okay. I'm just going to write down what it's actually called here. Posting. Hurry. Eel survey.
There will be other testing going on throughout the summer.
Yeah.
So, and we have asked, and we being Mike Bobinski, who has the Summer Swim Great Falls Dam, and us, would like to be notified because, you know, people are going to be wondering what the heck is going on at the river.
Right. So. Yeah, fair enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Note of that. Okay. Next thing on the agenda, training municipal budget process. How was it on May 2nd?
It was very, very good.
Okay. So
very informative.
I can't hear Denise, but I thought it was excellent.
Yes, I said the same thing. Very good.
Yes. And we had 12 people there.
Okay.
And including a 13th, the chair of the school board arrived for the last half hour.
Okay.
So it was really great. You know, one of the things that I learned, I mean, I don't know how we're going to be able to muster the resources to use it, but there are some different types of funds that we could be using, and Denise brought this up for, like, the detail work for the police, right?
Mm-hmm.
As well as the recreation committee. So there are ways to manage funds that could be helpful to us.
That's good to know.
Mm-hmm.
It's just trying to figure out the best match for each of these different kinds of funds.
Right.
And.
Was it taped?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, it was taped.
Try to find some time.
But Caroline, she didn't bring books for everybody. I have the latest book, budget book. So if one of you keeps reminding me, I will bring it in. And I believe there is something in there on these different types of funds. It may not be detailed enough, but it could be a good starting point.
So this book that you're talking about, is it issued by the Municipal Association?
Yeah, it's the Basic Law of Budgeting.
Okay. Do we know?
They update it every year.
Do we know how much the copies cost?
I don't, but I have one and I don't use it.
Okay. I'm wondering if it might.
I registered for September, last September.
Yeah.
And I had the same next thing. It wasn't as bad.
Yeah.
As it is right now, but I still, at the beginning, I couldn't drive, and so I couldn't get myself there. I said, but could you please send me the book?
Right.
So they did.
Well, I'm wondering, much like we have a copy of our zoning ordinance and a copy of the revised statutes for land use, that we provide to the budget planning board, it might make sense to, and then the ZBA gets the same book, I believe. It might make sense to have a copy for, well, for each of us on the select board, but also for each member of the budget committee.
Okay.
I mean,
so we can ask Caroline. We can ask Caroline to take a look at how much that book costs.
I mean, it's a tool that will help the process. Makes sense to me.
It will, and for people who, especially for people who went to the training, the table of contents will make sense. They'll go, oh yeah, I remember,
right.
And if they want more information, they can go in and they can take a look at that.
So I'll have Suzanne, we'll have Caroline look into the...
Well, Caroline, see how much they cost.
Okay. Adding that to my list of things to have.
But I will definitely bring mine in, so what if you can have mine?
And what is the book actually called? Do you remember?
It's called The Basic Law of Budgeting, is what I believe it's called.
Okay.
I mean, it's not just about the budget committee, it's how town municipal budgets are supposed to budget.
Right.
And there is conversation if you have an official budget committee, which you do.
Well, it makes sense.
Even if you don't.
I was just going to say, it makes sense for select board members and budget committee members to have it.
Exactly, because it talks about non-lapsing funds,
right.
It talks about, you know, the warrant articles and operating budgets and all those types of things.
All right. Anything else to say with the training? Now we're going to move on. All right. Lamprey Truck Sale. This is a wonderful piece of information. So Caroline, in my absence, attended the Lamprey Truck Consortium meeting, cooperative meeting, and we have received a winning bid for the truck. It was $40,000, which is more than what we had anticipated. Actually, I thought we were hoping to get between 30 and 40. We were really hoping to get up to 40, but no one really thought we were going to make it. The conversations that we had initially at the Lamprey group, we have gotten that. And the initial conversations were that each town then would be on the hook for a certain percentage of the remaining cost of the truck. Good news is that the larger Lamprey Regional Cooperative have agreed to absorb those costs. So each town now that is part of the trucking group will not have to do it, which is wonderful news. And the trucking group, as soon as the sale is completed, will be dissolved.
Yeah.
That's great news.
So
great news.
I think it's great news, yes. And so George is now looking at costs for hauling our municipal solid waste.
Yeah.
We currently have shipyard for recycling, some recycling. So I would imagine he would be starting there. I think from the conversation I had with their representative at the last meeting that I could attend of the cooperative, they were very excited and eager to have a conversation with Rollinsford, because they're already coming here to haul all of our waste, so. But he is gonna be looking at others.
You know, it makes sense.
Yep.
You know, we've been paying to go from Madbury to Rollinsford to Rochester to back here, back to Madbury.
Yeah.
Whereas if we could find a hauler who's already working this general area, we ought to be able to save on our hauling costs, is what I'm hoping.
Yeah.
I would also be remiss if I didn't mention that our driver actually passed away.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was mentioned.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, so, I'm sorry to hear about that, but.
Yeah.
It all just sort of, yeah. All the pieces, so it just, you know, it was really horrible, that kind of loss, so. Just, anyways, so.
Okay, well, right now, there's nothing for us to do.
Correct.
Other than to continue to work on looking for an alternative hauler, correct?
We need to have a plan in place by the end of June. By July 1, I believe, so.
Okay.
I'll double check that date, but I know it's in June, so it's not the beginning of June, so. I don't believe, so. So we will move on to recreation. We have Walmart grant, Dick's Sporting Goods sponsorship, see 423 email. I haven't seen 423. Alright, so Denise, do you wanna explain to those of us that?
Well, if we can let Celia come up and.
Alright, come on up, Celia.
She was actively writing the grants.
We're gonna try to do this in a expeditious manner.
So the grants have changed. The Walmart grant, like you weren't here last week, so the Walmart grant is no longer on the table. That's been taken off because we don't.
Cross that off, but no more Walmart.
We do not meet their needs.
Okay.
Or their.
Their standards.
Yeah, their qualifications. In the last week, I have talked to Eastern Bank. I was able to complete our application with them. And when I was on the phone changing the person from Suzanne to Denise, I found out that we were actually on a tip from Suzanne applying for the wrong grant. So the grant that we were applying for goes up to 500. The current grant is up to, I think, 25,000, but they request smaller grants so they can distribute to more communities. Mm-hmm. So a lot of them are in the below $10,000.
Okay.
And in order to change from Suzanne to Denise is not a problem. To change the email is a problem because each person in their system is connected to an email. Right now, the email is the select board. So if the email may be, say, Dear Suzanne or Dear Denise, but it goes to the whole select board.
Okay.
They wanted to express the caveat that only the person who originally sets up the account has access to the account. The person that sets up the account is the only one that has the ability to access and edit the account.
You've lost me. So like here. Who is they?
Eastern. So I set up the password and account profile through Eastern Bank.
But you haven't created an account with them.
I don't have like a bank account. It's just the grant application,
application.
Stored online.
Yes.
Has not been submitted.
Okay.
But it can only be accessed with my name and the email I put in. Even though the select board is listed as the financial officer and chief executive of the group, you do not have access to the application to edit or correct.
Alright, let me just comment to make sure I understand. All we're talking about, Celia, is the grant application stuff. So you are the person who is with the login to work on the just the board.
Correct.
But what about the funds?
Okay.
What if you got a grant? Who, are you the only one that is in control of that?
No, that's why they have you as the chief executive officer.
An email from the list. It's only the application process.
The application can only be, yeah.
So if you wanted, or I wanted to look at the application online, we would have to get the access information from Celia, because it's only Celia's code, not anyone who I'm looking.
And that's fine, but you still don't have the authority under the town of Rollinsford to do it on your own.
Right.
As we discussed last week.
Correct, and so.
Is it possible though to print, can you do a PDF, can you print the application?
I can, and what they did for me was they transferred the information we had in the other grant to this application. So they just transferred our information. There are a couple of things that I'm going to need assistance from the town on. So I've been working with the rec committee to set up a time. It doesn't look like the whole rec committee can meet. There were four or five of us that were needing to be actively involved, the two chairs, Denise, myself, and then my other fundraising partner. So we've been working on trying to come up with a time that we could meet to review the application. Right now, the best date for the two chairs looks to be this coming Friday. We have not met yet. So I don't know if anybody else can make it. Denise has given us some input.
Well, I can't make it, my father's here now, so.
So at the chairs and I might meet Friday to go over the applications, and then we can forward them to Denise for further review and meet with her at a later date.
That's fine.
Celia and the board, did you understand, you know, I made that suggested edit to the first paragraph of the history?
Yes. And I still need to get in contact with Optima Bank, they're based in Portsmouth, and clarify that we are still, that we will be eligible because we are not a non, because we are an entity of the town and not a nonprofit.
Right. So when, because when I read that first paragraph, or actually I think the whole thing maybe, it didn't seem like the rec committee was situated within a municipality, which of course it is. And the other point that I was trying to make is that while the board, in fact, as you know, challenged the rec committee to cover direct expenses, it's important for sponsors to know that a program has support. And so that's the point that I was trying to make by saying that the town provides administrative support, technical support, and space resources for the project.
And so I have thought about the Eastern grant, and I need to talk to the chairs to confirm a consensus among the rec committee, but I think it would be good for us to ask between $10,000 and $15,000. Between $1,000 and $1,500, excuse me, for the.
So why did you get, why were you disqualified for one and now going into a bigger category? What is this category that you are, and what's the word I'm looking for, you qualify for?
So they all, the category I was in said anything that's not included in the other categories, and all the other categories included 501(c)s. And knowing that I was not a nonprofit, that I was a town entity, mm-hmm. I figured, and they all request your tax ID number mm-hmm. associated with your nonprofit. So I figured we were in the 500 one because it says this is for all other applicants.
Sure.
And then when I was on the phone with, I believe they only have one or two grant coordinators for the whole company, she says, oh, you're a municipality. So that is not a neighborhood grant, that is a community grant, because you're doing something within the community of your town. So she's like, that is, and even though it says 501(c), you're a community entity. So that's the difference, I guess. It's a neighborhood grant versus community grant, and I can forward on the information that it lays out for the different grants.
Okay, so on the other, are you still pursuing the other grants that we had talked about last week?
So I'm looking further into the Optima Bank grant.
Yeah.
And then the Dix grant, I'm going to have the, I'm taking out the transportation paragraph and just using it for equipment. And I'm going to have the chairs review that also before it is submitted. So right now, those are the two primary ones I'm looking at, is the Eastern Bank one and the Dix Sporting Goods. And then the, for the Eastern Bank, I figured maybe $1,500 would cover doodle bugs coming in for one time to do glass fusing. And then either inviting them back to do a second time of either painting pottery for each individual student to paint pottery and have it there, or we could use the extra money in the account to go to the Wentworth House, which was something that was enjoyed by the campers last year, that we confirmed at our last rec committee meeting that the director would like to do again.
Okay, so in your detailed on your grant, those are the things that you're going to put in there.
Yes.
And you're going to make sure that you spend all of the funds on just those projects.
And when I was talking to the Eastern Bank Foundation, I asked what follow-up they would like to see to confirm that we were following all of their guidelines. They say they do not require follow-up. They take us at, they require the funds are spent on what we're going to say they're going to be spent on, but they do not require any follow-up sent to them. And I asked if there were any other obligations we had to meet, such as matching funds or anything when we changed grant categories and so forth, and they said there were none to be aware of. And I can get, I will include the phone number when I send out the application of the foundation so people can call and ask. And it's all under Rollinsford Recreation Committee, so you can just reference that application if you have any concerns. They'll be willing to answer.
Good. No, just make sure you keep it to what you can spend the money on in, in the given year. There's always next year for something else, you know, so you don't want to turn it back into the...
And I was actually thinking about the Dix one, in that we may be cutting it very close for summer rec. So I'm going to be talking to the chairs, because one of the chairs is also the basketball rec, rep, and seeing if we want to continue, expand the date a little longer, because they say you can, you create your own notification date. You have to give them a certain amount of time to let you know when you're going to be done. And so I was going to talk and say, if this doesn't come through timeline wise for summer rec, do you want to consider asking for basketballs and stuff like that? Just so that we can apply for it this year, and then we can apply next year for summer rec or something like that.
We have more time to think about throughout the whole year. I think that's a good idea. So,
So Celia, can I just butt in for a moment?
Of course.
Celia, what I hear you doing is excellent stuff. Calling the potential sponsor, you know, they have various names. You said grant coordinator, whatever they are, program officers, grant coordinator is the perfect thing to do. Because what you can try to find out is, what sorts of things do you find yourself funding? You know what I mean? To get an idea, what's the size and what is the sort of average size that you're funding? So you get an idea, so you can tailor your application to something that has a likelier chance of success. You know, if they fund things generally within the $500 range, then you don't want to ask them for $15,000 because you probably won't get it.
Yeah, right.
And so, and another thing, even though I heard you say, I think I heard you say that they didn't need any recognition or whatever, but you might also say that, you know, if you're looking for somebody to fund Doodlebugs, that, you know, you would list that in the program for summer rec, Doodlebugs funded by Optima Bank or Eastern Bank or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Exactly. Yeah, some recognition to the sponsor. I mean, those kinds of things that sponsors generally like to see, because it threads them into the community that they're trying to become threaded into.
But also, just when you, if and when you get the grants, just make sure you save all your receipts and you can turn them into Caroline, and we can create a file here of everything that you get for a grant. So just in case someone comes back and questions what you did, that's all. It's better to have too much than not enough.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The grant stuff has to be kept separately. It's restricted funds.
Right. Exactly. But just you know, I think your idea is right. Don't go over the edge and asking for too much. Just what you think you could use this year, and use it. And if it's, you know, buying a couple extra basketballs or whatever to use next year, that's fine, because it's still through the program, you know. So,
I think
you're doing good. So just keep me in the loop, and I gave you my information, but I can't make it this week. But if you have something in the future, just let me know.
So, yeah, I just got an email while I was here, so one other person can't make, but hopefully the two chairs and I can meet.
I think that's good, getting the three of you, the two chairs, the decision makers, and you in there.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
One more question, Celia and Denise. I looked at some of this stuff. Is there anything at the moment that you need me to look at? Or?
I think it's just following up. I will get back to you on what Optima Bank says, and then the chairs will, and I will meet, and hopefully we'll have stuff for you Monday to review.
That's good.
All right, but right now, my blackboard is clean.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes.
Thank you.
All
right, thank you. Item number letter I, Stratford Regional Planning Commission envisioning for the RFP for the village. James Burden, is he still coming in on next Monday, Suzanne?
He is coming, I'll verify that.
Okay.
Usually in the 7 o'clock time frame. I think it's Burdeen, I'm not sure.
Burdeen it is.
Burden, but I think he says Burdeen.
Okay.
And just so you know, I'm invited, just as a member of the public, not to share in the conversation, but I've asked Jackie Schroeder if she would like to come and listen to this part of the conversation. We just appointed her to the Conservation Commission, if you recall. She is very energetic, very excited about being a member of the community. She's a marketing PR person. I don't know if anything's going to come of this visioning at all, but I thought, you know, it might be something she might be interested in at least listening to in case something came in the future.
Okay.
So just letting you know.
Okay. Anything else to say about that? Okay. Item J, landfill annual post-closure report. That has remained in the folder because I had mentioned a meeting a while back that I was going to work with George on it when I got back from vacation. So
okay.
I will do that. And
bless you, Michael.
The suggestion to reach out to a former road agent is a good one, too. So that was here when it
came
closed.
Yeah, I came as a surprise to us last year. None of us have done this before.
Yeah. So, we're going to do it this year, though. So,
all right, excellent.
And I'll work on it with George, so it's on my to-do list.
Super.
K, initial conversation about meeting twice monthly. Can we table that?
Yes, table that.
Okay. Letter L, Oak Street boundary, preambulation. I am going to go do it. Look at my calendar. I'm going to try to do it. It's just going to be me, so I guess I don't need to notice it, right?
Right.
But
just perambulate to your heart.
All right.
Yes.
I've got to look at my calendar for this weekend and then next weekend, but it will be done in the next 2 weeks, so.
Okay.
Oh, joys. Hopefully it'll be a little drier. It has been raining here the last couple weeks. I don't know. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'll wait till it dries out then. Then we have winter versus comprehensive MOU. I believe that Mr., I'm going to forget his name, Blankenship from Dover was going to put a draft together.
Yeah, did he?
I don't know, I have not seen one, so.
Yes.
You did? Is there one in there?
I think so.
Oh, as I say, I haven't been here in the last 2 weeks, so maybe he did, but Donna says she thinks she saw something, so it comes through the mail. MOU from the city of Dover.
No, I think I filed it.
The winter one, I think.
Oh, it's.
We had the winter one. So I was remembering the winter one that she filed for us, so.
Yep.
So Attorney Blankenship, whichever one, Anthony, was going to put one together for us because they have a department that handles that sort of thing.
Right.
We could ask Caroline to reach out to our town attorney that was handling it.
Kevin Baum.
Kevin Baum, I was remembering Kevin's name, but.
Yeah, now we did let Kevin, so when I talked to John Storr, who's the new head of the community services Dover.
Yeah.
When I spoke with him, it's a few weeks back now, he was going to get back to me with one of my costs for Oak Street. He hasn't gotten back to me. I told him we had no money until 20-something.
Right.
And anyway, so I haven't heard back from him. And part of that conversation was a comprehensive MOU.
Yeah.
Not just winter.
Right.
But how are we going to manage the maintenance of the road?
Right. That's
entirely.
That's what the city attorney was going to get to us.
Exactly. And so we did let Steve/Kevin know that that was happening. And Kevin wrote back and said, okay, excuse me, I'll give Blankenship. Blankensop, I think.
Sop,
I'll give him the nudge. Now, this was over a month ago. So, I would say, in my own opinion, only because, you know, it costs us at least $35 just to ask questions,
right.
I might wait a month or so.
Right. I was going to say, they are doing
it. I don't care.
They are doing it gratis.
But, you know, even our questions cost, you know, $35.
Yep, exactly. All right, we want to wait out a week or two, that's fine. All right, anything else to say about RL? If not, we're going to move on to town administration, standing items. Board member activities/updates. Denise?
Well, due to my family situation, I had to cancel my attendance at tomorrow's meeting in Newington, so.
Oh, okay.
I'll try to catch another one.
Yeah.
But that's all I have.
Suzanne?
I don't believe I have anything other than trying to finish up the budget, CIP, and those kinds of things.
Right.
Newsletter.
Okay. I've got planning board tomorrow evening at 7 right here. I think that's it for the week. Something else pops up I can't remember, but so, and we'll be electing the chair tomorrow evening. So.
Excellent.
Yes, indeed. But I think that's it for board. Go ahead.
If you're just going to go folder work, I think I will bid you adieu.
Okay.
But I did want to point out one more thing on the budget.
Yeah.
You remember the issue of the planning consultants and the training? Where we paid the attorney?
Yes.
Yeah, so you'll see that if you look at the budget, you'll see we'll have spent more in planning consultant fees at this point this year than we did last year.
Okay.
And that's because we posted, just like we told John Kress that we would do, we posted it against his line.
Right. There is one other thing, though, that we wanted to take up before we got off the phone with you. I am aware of it. I talked to, that's one of the things that Caroline mentioned to me today. As in the past, we had a bus registered here in town that was, it was a lease, so it was registered to the leasing company.
Okay.
So when you and I or anyone else in town that's, you know, buys a car outright and we register it, if for some reason we buy a different vehicle, you know, and replace that one, the money that we paid, let's just say it costs $100 to register your car, and in the middle of the year, you're getting an accident, you're going to buy a new car, but you keep the same registration plate. You get a $50 credit towards your new registration because you haven't finished paying. The year hasn't ended, right? So the same thing holds true for the bus. This happened once before when I was first on the board. So C&J leased has a bus that they had been leasing. It has been replaced by a different bus. So they have a an amount of $719.25 that should be credited towards their new bus that is going to cost just about $10,000 to register, which is wonderful for us. But because it's through a leasing company, we can't credit it directly back to C&J because it was done under their subsidiary, a different leasing company. So we need to issue a refund.
They're asking for a refund.
Right.
So the refund comes out of what?
Well, that's... That's a good question.
Does Caroline know how we did it the last time?
Let's see. The amount due refund would be, it has an aside, no, it doesn't say. The email is from Caroline, so she is aware of it. Okay, so here, the part I didn't mention. So the first bus was a lease. The second one they're buying outright, so it's not a lease. So that's, it wouldn't be an issue if they were going from bus A if they owned it to bus B, but because of lease, that's why it's the issue. I can find out from her where it's coming from, but I guess the larger question is the board going to authorize that the $719.25 be refunded? We've done that in the past, so.
Well, if we've done that in the past, then I don't see any reason why we wouldn't do it again.
Yeah, it's for 7 months, so it comes out to $102.75 a month. But I don't think we've done it before, too.
And the new registration covers more than the refund.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then so.
And then another one is coming next month, so.
Right. So.
Yeah, so I guess, unless I'm not thinking clearly, which is quite possible, I mean, this seems like what we've done, so we will do it again.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, it's advantageous to the community, I would imagine.
Yes.
To give back the 719 to gain another, 20 in the next month or two, so.
Sure.
Two buses, so, it's just me. I would, okay, so, when we get, when it comes, we can do it now, if you want to just take it up, so, do you want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to reimburse, is it Jelbit Leasing?
I think so.
Jelbit Leasing, $719.25, reimbursing him for, money he paid on a leased vehicle and couldn't transfer it over to his now owned vehicle.
I'll second that. Okay. Just wanted to make sure you were aware of that, Suzanne. So I'll sign to authorize. Okay.
Suzanne?
Yes.
Last week we had one from that Intuit for the laser voucher checks, and we put a note on there to check and see if the treasurer was considering doing a bank change. It's back in there with the same information on another sticky with the same, a little different price though. So did you talk to Vern to see if they were going to do a bank change?
I did not talk to Vern, I talked to Caroline. Caroline said Vern is not interested in doing a bank change.
Okay.
So I would say then let's do what's the most economical.
Okay.
I think the two years worth sounds better, doesn't it?
Yeah, because the original slip was $1,000 for $369 and $2,000 for $288.50 a year. It would give us about 2 years worth of them. And they're sent, oh, I see, wait a minute, never mind. It's not different. They just told me what it was going to be each year. the amount, okay.
I have Caroline to do the math.
Yeah, yeah.
By the time we look at it, it's 9 o'clock at night, and we don't do math.
Yeah, so 2 years worth of checks is $577, and 1 year is $369. So, and it, you know, 1,000 versus 2,000. So I think it's worth going and getting the 2,000 if he's not interested in changing banks. We're not losing anything.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
So that sounds true.
Okay.
Again, I won't vote on it, but go ahead and choose you to.
All right. Okay.
Is there anything else that you think you need me for this, for us meeting as you go through the correspondence or whatever?
Hold on, one more. He's gonna look at.
We received from DRA, Suzanne, the 2017 sales assessment weighted means ratio. And so we have a form here that they're asking us to verify that.
You mean an equalized
assessment? Yeah, yeah. I'll just read it to you real quick. Earlier in 2018, you were notified of your town's 2017 sales assessment weighted means ratio. Since that time, the Department of Revenue Administration has completed the process of calculating the total equalized values for each municipality and unincorporated places throughout the state pursuant to an RSA reference. Two total equalized figures were calculated for each municipality. The total equalized value, including utility valuation and railroad monies reimbursement, will be used to calculate your municipality's portion of the county tax and cooperative school district, if applicable. The, quote, total equalized value not including utility valuation, railroad monies used to calculate each municipality's portion of the state education property tax. In order, so there's two different, there are two different assessments used to calculate two different tax rates, or two separate tax rates, or in some
cases. What are they?
One is, so not including the utility valuation is for the state education property tax, and everything else is based off of including. So, did you hear what I said? No?
Are they giving me the ratio or the percentage or whatever?
Yeah, I haven't gotten that yet. In order to fulfill the requirements of the statute, the adjustments have been made to the modified assessed valuation to bring such valuation to true market value. Enclosed with this letter are informational sheets to summarize how each of the following were calculated. This letter is official notification of your 2017 valuation. You have the right to appeal these valuations if you want to, so we don't have to do anything if we agree with the evaluations. That's all.
Oh, I see. All
haven't gotten to that part of the letter.
If you need that in the folder, I'll probably take a peek at it next.
Yeah, we'll leave it in the folder. We'll put a sticky note on it for Suzanne's review.
Okay.
Other than that, I think we're good.
Well, thank you so much for carrying on. I appreciate it.
No worries. I hope you're feeling better.
Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
And I hope I see you on Monday.
All right.
I hope so, too.
All right. Take care.
Take care.
You take care. Bye.
All right.
Okay.
We will finish this up then. Okay. What was I doing?
I have two POs as well, just to let you know.
We can do yours first if you want.
Oh, okay.
Carry on if you want. We'll do this one after.
Okay. So we have a purchase order for Camari Services, purchase order 1287, pruning of trees and removal of dead trees and limes? What's the limes? Oh, limbs. Sorry.
It's late.
It's late. For $1,000. And this is from the cemetery department.
Oh, okay. All right, I'll second then. Okay, so they're doing okay. They're pruning and all that. They do. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Thrown away. It's a Khmer Services. So Khmer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Why don't you see that? Get that to somebody so she knows what we're talking about.
And the other one is a PO for Intuit for the town office, a PO number 1428. To purchase Laser Secure Plus voucher checks for checking account.
Yeah.
And it depends how much you want, but it's $369 for 1,000 checks or $577 for 2,000 checks. We go through about 1,000 checks a year, they're saying. Mm-hmm. Plus shipping, which they're putting $25 for shipping.
And we've determined that the treasurer is not interested in torching banks.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. So what is your pleasure in? 2,000?
We should get, yeah, if you're not gonna switch banks for the, at least the tenure of the service, and that's 2 years.
Yeah, okay. About 2,000, so that would be, 577. Plus the shipping.
So, yeah, we looked into, I had looked into it years ago when I was treasurer and the town clerk slash, I can't think of the title, administrative assistant, wasn't interested, because we didn't want to go to a different bank, so we just abandoned it, the select board wouldn't support it, so. But, yeah, there are some advantages to going with other institutions, but whatever.
Okay. So you wanna call it up?
Not my call. Yeah, oh, so, did you move the $602 amount?
Mm-hmm.
I'll second that, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed? That's that one.
We have a notice here from, New Hampshire Association of Assessing Officials, presents a roundtable discussion on utility evaluation, May 16th at 6:00 PM in Tilton.
Oh, wow.
So, FYI.
Okay.
That's all I have in here.
That's it? Perfect, all right. First thing I have in here is, there's a whole bunch of stuff here that goes together, I guess. Ah, okay, so there is a, hair, salon, there's a salon moving into the mill, which is an approved use, so they don't have to go through planning, that's a good thing for them and the mill owner. So it's, the first is building permit 2018-041. And it's, okay, it says existing studio, they're moved, so there must have been one there before. They're moving two walls, building in a closet, a few other minor things. The fee is $225, it's been reviewed by Mr. Clark.
And who's this for?
Well, let's see.
Or something.
Apparently it was, the mill owner, so it says One Front Street, Unit 201.
201.
It looks like. Looks like they actually already did the work. Well, at least they're paying their fee, yes, it's a plus. And it's got a whole bunch of, it's got a whole bunch of the photos of the work that was done. Tom has, reviewed it anyways. Has reviewed all the work, that's a plus. Well, at least they did the work and they actually came to us, that's, you know, sometimes they just do the work and they never come to us, so. Anyways, it's $225, there's also a certificate of occupancy, so they can open their studio, we'll get to in a moment, but we'll sign off on this.
Do you want to see it? Can I say who it is? It's called Studio Mundi, I guess.
Oh, the certificate of occupancy.
That comes next.
Yeah, that comes next, but it doesn't say it on here. Studio 90 is the name of the place.
All right, so the next thing is a certificate of occupancy for a salon Studio 90, for One Front Street, Unit 201. It has been, inspected by Mr. Clark today. And found to be compliant with the zoning and building requirements that currently exist in the town of Rollinsford, so. As soon as they pay their fee of $225 and their fee of $50, they can open their studio.
Do
building permit 2018-030, I think. That was the last one. It's in marker and it's been crossed out. Yeah, 030. It's 80 Roberts Road. It's a new construction. Mr. Clark has reviewed and has revised the estimates for the new construction. The new fee will be $2,395.
Oh, is that over his whole Commons Hotels?
Yeah, for that lot that he
okay.
cleared and subdivided there. Think. It's all, yeah, it all goes together. That's it. Alright, we're gonna send those back and now we're done looking at it. Alright. I don't have anything else in my folder. You don't have anything. You know what I'm gonna do though? I'm gonna sign checks. Have any community input?
Yes. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
The only question I have is when are the videos, when's the video for the training going to be available?
Have you looked on the town website? Should be there. They were going to put it up.
Okay.
Tamara did it.
I don't, I wasn't here.
My understanding was she was going to do it right away.
I would like to watch it myself. I do not know.
Okay.
So.
But it's going to be on the town website.
Yeah, well, I went
to,
yeah.
Okay, so I guess when, if it's not available, then we send a notice out too when it's available,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's not mine, that's yours.
Yeah.
All right, we're having the wrong folder. I don't even have a key to get in to put it away, so. I'm sorry, was that anything else? Celia.
My couple questions for you guys. When you revised the transfer station to reflect the $5 charge. You had discussed a couple weeks ago that those peel off and can go on a new car, the stickers. Or is that not possible? You're just gonna put in the $5? Or can we peel them off and put them on a new vehicle?
Well, it's tied to, it has your registration number on the sticker.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be valid anyways.
But if we transfer registration, then we still have the same plate.
You're keeping the same, yeah, I know. You know, I don't know. That's something I would bring up, Celia, at a public hearing. Because I don't know, to be honest with you.
Okay.
I can't answer it tonight, I don't know. But something I can certainly keep in mind when I'm trying to revise it.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it comes off that easy that you would be able
yeah,
to
I don't,
do that, though.
I don't know either, to be honest with you. But
because I figured if it was just peeling off, I could save myself a couple of dollars. My issue's been resolved. I can't do that. And then you're sending out a letter for dumpsters. Does
yep.
it have to be a dumpster, or can it be a trash barrel? Because I know in my neighborhood there is a four-unit building that provides trash barrels for each unit.
Right.
And then what do they do with it, though?
Because that's
then
what
it goes
the old,
to a transfer
that's
station.
What the old ordinance allowed.
But then it goes to a transfer station,
no,
where a dumpster wouldn't.
Correct. So,
but the renters have a transfer station sticker and could drive it there themselves.
Could indeed, if they wanted to. But, the new ordinance, I believe, says that, I had to go back and look at it again, but anything four units or more, I think it said it had to have a dumpster. Or, provide trash removal. I had to go back and look at it, but clearly it's that it's not to be taken to the town transfer station. It's to be, they could hire, I don't know, what's that,
the
guy that drives around, I see
around,
the,
yeah.
Mike something, not me, garbage removal, or, it's waste management, one of those people. Or they can get a dumpster. I think I don't remember who takes ours. Pine Tree
I was just wondering, because in my neighborhood there's two different systems. One has a dumpster,
yeah.
one
no,
has barrels.
It's a good question. But the new ordinance is much clearer than, well, at least I hope it is, than the previous one. So.
That's all.
That's it. Anything else? All right, well, we bid you all adieu until next week.